It's a ministry that believes in honesty, transparency, and the Word of God. This is Greater Works Community Fellowship Church of God in Christ, encouraging God's people to encourage the world. Let's explore the truth, where the Word of God begins to open our hearts, our mind, and spirit right now.
This is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Welcome to Greater Works Community Fellowship, Church of God in Christ service. We just expect miracles to take place on this day. And we just thank God for you joining us this morning on Facebook Live. It is good to see each and every one today. Come on in. As you come in, let's have an attitude of worship. Let's have our minds focus in on the Lord. It is for Him we have our bodies. It's for Him we have our thoughts. It's because of Him we have our well-being. We just got to give God praise on this morning, for He made all things possible. And because of this, we just love on Him on this wonderful Sunday morning. So God bless you. My name is Pastor Gordon McKinney, and I am pastor of Greater Works Community Fellowship Church of God in Christ in the wonderful state of North Carolina, Wake Forest, North Carolina. And we just give God praise on this morning. It's been a while since I've had a service live, and I just thank God. I've been traveling for the past couple of weeks, and God dispatched His traveling angels, saw fit for me to come back before you another time. So I just give God praise, and I give God thanks for all those who have been tuning in. And I do believe I have a word from the Lord on this morning. God is going to bless, and He's faithful in all His ways. And we just thank God for how He continues to bless us during this time. And like I said earlier, I do have a word from the Lord. So if you have your Bibles, I hope that you can turn with me The Gospel of Luke, Luke 5, 33 through 39. The Gospel of Luke, Luke 5, 33 through 39. And the word is as follows. And they said to him, "Why do the disciples of John fast often and make prayers, and likewise those of the Pharisees, but you eat and drink?" And he said to them, "Can you make the friends of the bridegroom fast while the bridegroom is with them? But the days will come when the bridegroom will be taken away from them, then they will fast in those days." Then he spoke a parable to them. "No one puts a piece from a new garment on an old one. Otherwise, new makes a tear, and also the piece that was taken out of the new does not match the old. And no one puts new wine into old wineskin, or else the new wine will burst and the wineskin and be spilled, and the wine will be ruined. But new wine must be put in new wineskins. Both are preserved. And no one have drunk old wine immediately desires new, for he says the old is better." God, we thank you for this word. We ask that this word will bless your people, oh God. And God, we ask that you just watch over us during this time, oh God. God, have your way in our lives, oh God. And all these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Today I'd like to talk about the pioneer's perspective. The pioneer's perspective. Living in the South, it's not odd that from time to time you will see a Confederate flag. And as of lately, we've been had to endure the Confederate soldiers' statues. And these are monuments and relics of the past. These are old traditions that a lot of Southerners will not give up, because they tie these symbols, they tie these men of old to a history that is steeped in violence, it's steeped in racism, and it's steeped in destruction of families. The problem is the fact that there are people that can't let those things go. As a matter of fact, they uphold them, they relish them, they cherish these symbols of the past. But we must understand that we live in a new era. We live in a new society. Yes, it's good to remember the past, but we have to understand if the past is a relic that is not promoting the future. If it's a relic that is holding down the progressiveness of what's to come, we must analyze all these things, and we must propel ourselves to move forward in a society in which we can all come together as one. Much like these who are holding on to these old traditions in the South, Jesus had to fight those who held on to the traditions of the Hebrew culture. You see, the Lord sent his son to give a new perspective of faith to the believers. And here in this scripture, Jesus is confronted for what he was doing, what he was teaching. Jesus, in this framework, in this scripture, he confronts the Pharisees, the followers of John. Yes, they were stuck in doing the same old thing, the same way. Jesus says, I come to give you a new perspective of this gospel, to tell you that the Jesus, he was here to come to shake up the world. So here we have to deal and grapple with the pioneer. Jesus was the pioneer. Jesus was the trailblazer in this text. And as Jesus being the trailblazer, he has to confront all these traditionalists who are steeped in the old way. Jesus was constantly challenged by his non-traditional methods, his innovative teaching, and fresh ideas. And as we look at the scripture, Jesus is being challenged by the Pharisees. As we navigate, and I want to challenge you, as we navigate during this season, during this COVID season, it's been 2.5 years that we are dealing with this new time in our life. I implore the saints of God to be open to the Spirit and embrace change. Many of us churches, we no longer are in the sanctuary like we used to be. No longer are we packing the houses of God like we used to. No longer are we coming to service willy-nilly without the mask or without having the freedom of getting around and doing the things that we used to do. And so I want to tell the church, and I want to tell the believers, that in times like these, we have to understand God is talking to us as a body. Jesus is saying that when change comes, we must move with the Spirit. We must embrace change. Word of caution, embracing a new way of doing things can attract critics. It's a distraction for those who are comfortable of the status quo. They want to do everything to keep things the same way, even to the point where they want to sabotage your plans. Jesus was dealing with Pharisees that saw him as a threat. They wanted to dismantle, debunk, find things that was wrong with him, because they had this custom of culture down through the years that they clave to, they held on to. Here in the text, we see Jesus had his own haters, detractors. And through the word, he shows us how to deal with short-sightedness in people. You see, Jesus, I said, was a pioneer. And he had, as a pioneer, he had his own perspective. He had a perspective that was given to him by his Father. And sometimes when God gives you a perspective, a new way of thinking, a new attitude, a new way of approaching an issue, a lot of times people don't see it. A lot of times you will find yourself challenged to explain yourself, even though God explained it to you, but not everybody will hear the word that God gives you. Yes, people want to keep doing things the same way. And I want to tell you right now, if we as a body of believers that have gone through this 2.5 years of COVID-19, and we don't come out of this thing changed, if we don't come out of this thing with a new perspective as it relates to reaching the lost, woe unto us. Here in the scriptures, Jesus is dealing with people that are suffering from being short-sightedness. They only can see a few feet past their faces. But when we are looking in the lens of a pioneer, there are few things that we need to keep note of. One, don't get caught up in comparing the past to the present. Verse 33 says, "Then they said to him, 'Why do the disciples of John fast often and make prayers, and likewise those of the Pharisees, but yours eat and drink?'" Here they are trying to come against Jesus on his way of ministry. See, the Pharisees weren't open to the move of God. They weren't open to the change that was to take place. Brothers and sisters, there is a problem when you're always comparing. One of the things as a pastor, I can tell you right now, if you ever join a new church, it is almost like nails on a chalkboard when a member says, "Well, in my old church, we used to do this." Yeah, I understand, but that was what God gave that pastor for that season. Be pliable. When you have a situation, you're moving to a new place and you're going to a new ministry, allow the Lord to speak to you for that minute at that ministry. Allow the pastor to do what he has been doing. There's no problem giving suggestions, but remember that one ministry may do one thing one way, and the new other ministry may do one thing their way. Allow yourself to be pliable for change. Here the Pharisees were talking about John's followers. They were talking about how they followed the word, but yet they negated what Jesus was doing. Jesus answered them. Brings me to my second point. Realize who Christ is and act accordingly. See, they were trying to make comparisons to John the Baptist. They were trying to make comparisons to how they traditionally did their things. But I'm going to tell you something. One of the worst things you can do in a relationship, you're married and you're with your spouse, and then you bring up, "Oh, you know, my old boyfriend used to do this way. My old girlfriend used to do this way." Well, the spouse is going to say, "Well, why didn't you marry that person?" Here, Jesus is being confronted by the Pharisees. He's saying, "Look, why aren't you doing it this way? Why aren't you doing it that way?" But Jesus came to earth as the fulfillment of the law. See, they did not realize who Jesus was. They didn't see Christ for who he was. So that brings me to this point. Realize who Christ is and act accordingly. Hear what Jesus says. He says, and he said to them, "Can you make the friends of the bridegroom fast while the bridegroom is with them? But the days will come when the bridegroom will be taken away from them, and they will fast in those days." There's no need to fast because Jesus is the Savior. And he was there with them. You see, the Pharisees didn't recognize who Jesus was. Jesus established himself as the bridegroom. There's a significance of who the bridegroom is in Hebrew culture. The betrothal groom leaves the father's house to get a bride. As that process takes place, there's a preparation that takes place in the Hebrew culture. The groom goes back to the father's house to build. The groom goes back to the father's house to build the house suitable for the wife and himself. Scripture says, "I go and prepare a place for you." It's an undisclosed period of time. The bride stay at the father's house where she receives instruction on how to become a suitable wife. This is what's going on currently with the current church. And the church currently is learning through the gift of the Holy Spirit how to be that perfect bride, because the scripture proclaims that Jesus is going to come back for a bride without spot nor wrinkle. And so we have to perfect ourselves. We have to allow the Holy Spirit to work that perfect work in us. And then the return of the bridegroom. The groom returns usually at night, and it surprises the bride. It's a processional that is done with great pageantry for the community to behold. The Lord himself shall descend from heaven and shout with the voice of the archangel. That was found in 1 Thessalonians 4 and 16. Now, how many of y'all have been married before? No. Being married and planning for a marriage, the appeal of wedding is it symbolizes a new beginning. There's always a good feeling when you're at a wedding, so much cheer that takes place. It symbolizes a new day, new things are about to come from these nuptials. A new name, a new ring, a new covenant. See, here Jesus is telling the Pharisees that I am the new way of doing things. Third perspective of a pioneer is be open to saying out with the old and in with the new. Jesus goes into speaking a parable, and he says, then he spake a parable to them. No one puts a piece from a new garment on an old one. Otherwise, a new makes a tear. And also the piece that was taken out of the new does not match the old. And no one puts new wine into old wineskins, or else the new wine will burst and the wineskins be spilled and the wineskin be ruined. But new wine must be put into new wineskin and both be preserved. Romans 6 and 4 says, we also should walk in the newness of life. 2 Corinthians 5 and 17 says, any man be in Christ is a new creature. All things passed away. Here in this scripture, Jesus is talking about new wine and old wine. And what does that all mean? Well, let me give you the process of fermentation. Yeast and sugars interact and create a carbon dioxide within winemaking process. And this gas is secreted and it swells the wineskin. This collagen and protein gives a new wineskin its stretching ability, allowing the leather to adjust and hold the contents without breaking. But after that process, it takes place, the wineskin reaches its capacity and it loses its resilience. The skin's ability to contract and stretch again has been lost and rendered. And the container becomes an old wine skin. Here Jesus is saying that I'm the new wine. I'm the new way of doing things. And you're trying to put my new way of doing things into old wineskins. You have to change your thought process. You have to change the way you think when it comes to this gospel. Brothers and sisters, I refuse to be old wineskin. The old wineskin lost its ability to grow. It's been stretched to its capacity. It's been rendered useless. And as it relates to the things of God, my prayer is that God pour into me and stretch me and allow me to learn more of him. Help me realize who you are. Help me to stop quenching the spirit by constantly looking backwards in the past. Help me embrace the newness of a spirit and all of its blessings. My prayer is, pour into me, Lord. Stretch me, Lord. Allow me to see you for who you are. Allow me to follow your will. Accept your way. Here Jesus concludes his passage by saying, "And no one having drunk old wine immediately desires new, for he says the old is better." Jesus is speaking to those who are stuck in their old ways. These are the same people that go to the same restaurants for the past 20 years. Same people that wear the same suit for the past 15 years. Continue to wear the same hairstyle. People stuck in the 80s. People praying the same old prayers. Singing the same old songs. But the book says, sing unto me a new song. Like old wineskins, you will break when a fresh wine is poured into you. Pray that we find ways in which we can build bridges, find new arenas of ministry, to think outside the box. This season, like new wineskins, we should allow God to expand our thoughts, our spirits, and our desires to seek after him. We live in a new era. Things have changed. Right now, jobs are trying to figure it out. How are we going to get people to come back? Because there's this era right now called the Great Resignation. People are starting to trying to figure things out for themselves. And why did I allow myself to be stuck in this job, this dead end job, year after year after year? And how precious life is. And I want to see new things. I want to experience new experiences. I want to be able to see what all God has for me. I get that. I understand that. And this is what Jesus is saying. Jesus is a pioneer. And he had that pioneer's perspective. You can't hold on to all these old things when you have the newness of the Spirit upon you. So my prayer to you is, don't be like that old wineskin and burst. Don't be the new cloth on old clothes that will tear. It is time to allow the Spirit to move you, take you places that you've never been before. Allow the Spirit to allow you to do things, say things that you've never said before through the unction of the Holy Spirit. Step out, being a trailblazer, being a pioneer. That's what Jesus was. That's who Jesus was. He was a pioneer of his times. We too must be pioneers during this time that we're living in. Allow the Lord to use you like never before. Amen and amen. At this time, prepare yourself for Holy Communion. This morning I'll be reading for 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 through 26. And the scripture reads, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, also he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Hallelujah. Today we reflect on Jesus and a discussion he had with his disciples during the conclusion of his earthly ministry. It was a table discussion. It was the Last Supper. During that meal, he talked about the things that were to take place in the future, in the near future. And at the table, he gave thanks. He took the bread and said, "This bread symbolizes my body that will be crushed for you. Take, break, and eat." Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Then later that night, he took the wine. He said, "This wine represents my blood that will be shed for the remissions of sins. This is the new covenant. Take, drink. Drink ye all of it." God, we thank you and we praise you and give you glory. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. God bless you. I just thank God for you joining in with us on this morning. May God's face shine upon you. May you have a wonderful and prosperous week is my prayer. Take care. God bless you.
Thank you for watching Greater Works Community Fellowship Church of God in Christ. Join us on Wednesdays for Bible study. Greater Works always searches deep in the Word for guidance in our lives throughout the week. Make sure to join us on Zoom on Wednesdays at 7 p.m. Information to enter into our Zoom session is on your screen. And join us Friday mornings for our 6 a.m. weekly prayer call. The number and code information are posted on the screen, and we encourage everyone to attend virtual Sunday school with us at 9 a.m. This quarter is being taught by yours truly, Deacon Dennis Blunt, who is always excited about diving and exploring into the scriptures. If you love what you hear and see, well, please support our ministry. Remember, we have various ways for you to give. You can give through Giblify. Just type Greater Works Community Fellowship. You can also give on Cash App. Just type in $GWCF Ministries. Finally, you can pay through PayPal by going to our website at shallyoudo.org. There you will see the PayPal insignia. We also encourage everyone to visit our YouTube channel at the Shall You Do channel. You will find our ministry content on demand. Make sure to like it, subscribe, and share. Every time we upload new content, you'll be notified so you can view all of our on-demand messages. Music provided by Trumpet and Harp Music. This is a 2022 Greater Works Community Fellowship production. All rights reserved.